Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined by another returning guest on this season. The other person, I can no longer say that I'm always the host of this podcast, because the person I'm speaking to was the other host for an episode. It's the Fair City Hooligan himself. It's Brent Carter. Welcome back to the show.
Hello, thank you. Thanks for having me on again.
I'm very excited for this. Well, this was, as it's called, episode 138, as requested. We'll get into that in a little bit. I'm just going to warn everyone, just in case I finish recording, get the video out, and the audio is terrible at my end. I have changed, for anyone listening to the audio, I've got rid of the guard for the microphone, and I'm just going for the muff. So if anything goes wrong in the sound, blame it on the muff. There's a t-shirt for you if you want to use that in the future. So yeah, I'm just terrified that it's going to be like the Craig Berry episode where I just sound really far away. But that was because I was using the guard and the muff, and I'm hoping it just looks more aesthetically pleasing. Although if you screenshot it, it just looks a bit more, weird. Anyway, the first question is the most important when it comes to these podcasts, as always. And we're going to start off with a bang. What did you get with your PS5? What games did you get with your PS5?
It arrived like about 4:30 today, and I've still not had a chance to play it, because I thought if I set it up, then chances of me being on time for this interview would be very slim, and I'm nothing if a professional. So it came with Horizon, I think it's called, I don't know. I've been trying to get a PS5 for ages, and then I follow this account on Twitter that like lets me know when places have it in stock so I can keep trying, and it's never worked. But then it said that EE had them in stock for people that are on an EE phone contract. And I was like, oh, cool. So I went on EE, and there was like no queue or anything. It was just like, yeah, you can just add it to your phone contract and you can just pay up a month and we'll deliver it to you tomorrow. And I was like, yes, please. So I ordered it yesterday. It came today. Still not played it yet. But it came with Horizon, which I've got no idea what it is. I think I've got some games that I bought before that are cross-gen.
Upgraded and all that kind of stuff. Yeah.
So that'll be what I'm doing after this.
Horizon, I think they put out free a weekend for the PS4, because I downloaded it and I've started playing it, and my gaming habits are just so nondescript now. It's just Fortnite.
I'll put it in because it's the only game I've got, and I'll give it a bash. Mm-hmm. But it's already planned that I'm gonna trade it in and then use that to get WWE 2K22, because yeah. So I'm not planning on hanging on to it unless it's like amazing, but I don't really know what it is, so I'll give it a go, and if it's all right, then that's a few days of playing of that, and then it's going and I'm getting 2K22, and hopefully it's not as much of a shambles as 2K20 was. But we see. I'm optimistic, so
I didn't mind 2K20, except it just crashed all the time, and that's a fairly big bad thing to have about it. But I don't know if I'm going to wait and get 2K22 later when it's a little bit cheaper, because like I say, I don't play enough games now for me to warrant getting one. I still have a PS4 and just that'll do. Although it's now starting to get slower, which those bastards at Sony are clearly doing something, so it means that it's been going, oh, I'm going to have to get a PS5 so all my apps are faster and working again, because I did that with the PS3 and they're doing it with this again.
It's all a ploy, yeah.
I mean, I don't believe in many conspiracies, but that and iPhone does the same. Apple does the same with their devices, because I'm quite happy with mine, but I know when it comes rolled around for renewal in November, some stuff, my battery life won't be as hunky-dory as it has been before, and it'll just start. Anyway, this is a very boring chat at my end here, so let's
God, I was about to start talking about my iPhone. I was like, yeah, I've had a notification saying that there's an update ready to install, and it'll install overnight for like the past like over a week now, and every night it's like, yeah, update failed, and I'm like, oh no, it's on its way out. I've had it for like 2 years, and it's like, right, this is it, you'll need a new one now. It's been 2 years, that's average shelf life, buy a new one, keep feeding. It's not Steve Jobs anymore. I don't know who's in charge of Apple now.
Mr. Apple. Right. Okay. Let's get into the actual chat itself. So, the first question we tried asking these return ones, although I was distracted by the PS5 because you notified me before our chat that your professionalism has stopped you from setting up. How are you doing?
What a question. I'm a bit better than I was. I've not been great. I had a bit of a mental breakdown like earlier last year. Like proper legit, don't really know what happened. I just sort of had a steady decline in my mental health until it got to a point where it was like really bad. That was in like August. So like since then, like I've been off work since August. That's coming up like nearly half a year now, and I'm still not back. I've been like put on some meds, which have gradually been getting increased in dosage. I've had some therapy, which was weird because it was during the pandemic, so it was all over like Zoom, which lasted for about 6 weeks. That was all they gave me, but 6 weeks wasn't really enough to sort of dig into everything that was up. So then I got put on a waiting list for another therapy thing, which is I'm waiting to hear back on. But I'm starting to get a bit better. But yeah, it's been a bit of a weird ride since we've last spoke.
I mean, well, last time would have been the 100th episode. So that was a fair while ago. I can't remember when that was actually, but
I was going through it at that point, but like I think prior to that, I don't know if you remember, like I was doing those things for the SWN where I was doing like the play your cards right thing, yes. Where I had the one with you with the WrestleMania cards, and then had that second one planned where it was going to be me against Craig Berry, Brody Adler, and Omar Muhammad, and we were all just going to have like our lists of top matches from like NXT takeovers. Mm-hmm. And it was like it was round about that point where things were starting to get really bad, which is why the second one hasn't seen the light of day, because I just like hit a massive decline. But like apart from that, I'm fine. Yeah, things have been all right. got engaged.
There we go.
That was a good thing. Got engaged in December. We were over in Seattle for Christmas and New Year. And managed to keep that a surprise. Good things, bad things, but it's been eventful.
I mean, as long as you concentrate on the little things, I suppose, or the big things when it comes to getting engaged and everything, hopefully it keeps you kind of balanced or whatever. I mean, stuff like that, I have no way of kind of going, oh, I've been through it myself, because I haven't. that's just the simple fact of it. Unfortunately,
it's quite common, I think, because wrestling, most folk that are like really into wrestling, there's normally something there where there's like an issue. It might not be like the same thing for everyone, but there's normally the people that seem to gravitate towards wrestling, there's like something, or like I've found from other people I've spoke with, like it seems to be that wrestling fills something for them that they're lacking, or like it's like a sort of escapism. I know that like when I was younger, I used it as like a form of escapism. I'd watch wrestling and be like, ah, if I was that big and strong and that, things like this wouldn't happen to me and stuff. So like it attracts all sorts.
It's definitely a variety, but no, I get the escapism, but definitely that's my, if I've had a rubbish day or that, I'll throw in some wrestling or what have you. So yeah, I get that as well. So heavy start to the episode,
but yeah, I've just good. hit it with a downer straight away. So like, I mean, it the just only means way is up now.
Exactly. But that's just life, isn't it? It's just life. You've got to speak about it, because if you keep it all bottled up, then things will happen. I think the best thing that you possibly did then, because I didn't know. We didn't notice. I didn't notice on social media or anything. I think the best thing you did was kind of, I don't know if you drew yourself back from social media specifically, so you weren't, I don't know, reading tweets and just making yourself feel worse, or I don't know. It just happened naturally, and you're just like, oh, I don't need to be on Twitter today, and just avoided it entirely.
There was a bit, I know that, like, and more recently, I've not been as active on my social media stuff because my workplace, because I've been off work, like they've been in touch every so often with like sort of, they call them like absence support meetings. They try and like see how you're doing, but it's really a sort of like, are you ready to come back to work type thing. But turned out someone at my work knew about like my wrestling stuff, and then they were like, oh, if you're off work, then are you able to like go to wrestling training or stuff like that? So I've been like, okay, that's, so I've kind of been a bit more quiet on social media because I'm like, that's snaky. Yeah, I mean, my manager, I had meetings with my manager, and she was like, oh, well, normally if you're having like problems with your mental health and you've got low mood, like you can do things like exercise or stuff like that, or do you do stuff like that? And I was like, well, I had my wrestling training. I stopped going for a wee while. So I was like, I stopped going for a while. Like I've not really been to the gym in a while because I was like, I really, like it was at a point where like, I didn't really want to leave the house. And so like my manager was trying to encourage me to like start doing things again. And then I started doing things again. And then like the next meeting, it was like, so how come you're able to do this, but you aren't able to come back to work? And I'm like, ah, I have been set up. This is an attack. So I kept quiet for a bit, but we've had like other talks about it now, and they sort of realize how it's like a completely different situation.
Oh yeah, it's not a physical thing.
But like my job out with this is like I'm a support worker for like disabled people, and I'm of the mindset of like, well, while right at this point where like I feel like I can't look after myself, how am I supposed to be able to look after someone else? Like that's, I'm really not in the right mindset to do that. And so like we've had discussions, and so I've started to like get a bit more active again because we've sort of cleared up how it's completely different and it's not a conflict of interest or anything. And if anything, me doing this is sort of getting my like mood elevated back to a point where like I might be able to return back to work sooner.
I mean, it's a hard job. I mean, my wife was a support worker for a bit, and because she thought it would be something different because she worked in the office for so long, and it was just so hard on her mentally. And it was, she eventually had to just go back to an office job because it was just so tough for her. And it's just one of those things where it's just not for some people. And you've got to be in you got to be a bit thick skinned, and you got to be. Yeah. And if you're coming in with a crack in that skin, then not on purpose or anything, but your service users will find it. And it, again, it's not their fault; they're not doing it on purpose, but they find it.
Yeah.
Speaking of someone with a brother with autism, who apparently isn't able to understand things, he fucking understands stuff. He knows full well what annoys me. So it's just
100%. Yeah.
One of those things. So it's, yeah. Anyway, let's. Oh, last point.
No, you go. What were you saying? Oh, no, I was just agreeing. Yeah, like, not so much in the role I'm in now, but I know, like, the company I worked with before was dealing a lot more with, like, the mental health aspect of things. Like, the guys that I supported for that job were, like, people that had been committed to a, like, mental hospital and were living there. And then it had been decided that they still required support, but they didn't require as much support as they were receiving at the mental health place, like the hospital they were at. But they weren't quite ready to be integrated completely with society. So it was like a sort of, it was like sheltered housing, but just for like people with mental health issues. That was like not horrible because it was a really rewarding job. It was really tough. But the place I'm at just now isn't as bad because it's mostly dealing with guys with like physical disabilities. There's a lot of like wheelchair users and stuff like that. So like I love my job and I miss it and I'd like to go back to it. I'm just like, I wasn't ready. I still don't know if I am, but we're getting there. But yeah, it's a tough profession, I think.
And it's a thankless task at times, yeah, as well. I mean, someone who's been able to work through all this pandemic and on my little desk here, it's I don't need any thanks because I haven't done anything. I barely leave the house now. But yeah, for stuff like that, retail and support, it's just it's a task that was looked down upon before pre-pandemic. And now you realize how important it is in society that you need these roles and jobs to be done in order for the world to actually work at the same time.
Anyway, we will move on from the complete downer that I have just forced upon everyone.
That's fine. We'll pick it back up, I'm sure. How is the Day of Birth Bonanza Championship being looked after? Is it?
It's good. It's
being polished regularly.
I keep making the joke that like I've debt-holed it and that it's fine, but like realistically, this is an explicit episode, so fuck it. Like I'm not that well endowed that it was gonna touch it. Like it was like there was no contact made really. Like the worst thing is like a bit of the backstrap might have touched my arse, but like realistically it's fine, you know. Everyone was making such a big deal out of not wanting it anymore. Like I'm not that big a guy. It's fine, trust me. But at the same time, like, I don't want rid of it. It's my cherished possession. I will defend it whenever needed. But I do not, like, it's my pride and joy.
I don't know what we're going to do with it this year, because, of course, people will know by now, I'd hope so, because it's coming out in April, that of course, I'll be taking an extended break of recording in July. Fingers crossed, touch wood, all that kind of stuff, because I'm going to become a dad.
Yeah, you are.
Which is terrifying. And this is the first episode I can actually speak about it, because last episode went out with Kurt Cooper in this timeline. I kind of started speaking a little bit about it, but it's before we actually announced it, so I don't want to say too much. So we're going to have to organize a Day of Birth Bonanza rematch, whether it's the same. Maybe we can get Jason Hyde on this time. That would be good. Maybe. But I still like that I put him in the thumbnail, even though he's not on the episode at all. Because we spoke about him so much during it that I thought he's going to have to be on the thumbnail.
Throughout the entire episode, we're like, he's probably just going to turn up at the end. And like, so there's no point in saying that he's not going to be on it because chances are he'll show up in like the last half hour. And then like we found out why he wasn't on it and it was all very sad. But Maybe we'll get him for the second one.
It made the episode, but no, I've got plenty of plans. I mean, we're still, hopefully, I might have to ramp up and put two episodes a week out so I can get to episode 164 so I can get Brody back on. Yes. You know, all this kind of fun stuff that I've got planned. But yeah, it's just a case of trying to organize them in the next.
Since I already like have the prize from the first day of Birth Bonanza, if I win the second one, can you name the baby after me? Like, can we do that?
I don't think I can get away with that, unfortunately.
Baby Brent. It's...
Oh, Jesus. It just sounds like it would just do the old every time it gets up. Baby Brent. I'll consider it, but I can absolutely guarantee it will not get past my lips without a no being responded to very quickly. But I won't say no. I won't say no. Kelly will.
Loophole this.
Yeah, there we go. So yeah, Day of Birth Bonanza champion. We'll hopefully get a rematch coming soon. Right. Yeah, you requested episode 138. That was the one you wanted to be on. Why?
Two reasons. Firstly, like, I'm a big fan of the Misfits, which, like, anyone that really, like, pays any attention to my gimmick knows that, like, about 30% of it is just me stealing things from the Misfits. Like, my t-shirt design is a completely rip-off of one of their albums. They have a song called We Are 138, and like 130 is like a big thing with it. I'm actually, yeah, hello for the video people. So there was that, but then also because of The Simpsons 138th episode spectacular hosted by Troy McClure, I was like, I want a 138th episode spectacular because I love The Simpsons. So it was like just two of my interests with the same number. I was like, I need that episode. Give it to me, please, Billiam.
And you did. You've got it. Thank you. You got it. I'm not one. If someone wants to be on, I will just go with their request. If they want to be on a certain number, go for it. I will do it. Except like your biggies, I'll kind of reserve like 150 and all that kind of stuff to try and do something special, even though I have no plans to do anything particularly special, and my brain's trying to work one week at a time at the moment with, you know, trying to organize and think of all the grown-up stuff I'm gonna have to do at the end of the or towards the end of the year, which is terrifying. So yeah, so we're here, 138th episode of the SWN podcast. Not to say that you've got a lot to live up to, but the last guest I spoke to was Big Demo for the episode that came out as of this time, this just past Monday. So, you know, take that as you wish.
I mean, there's a big gap between that episode getting released and this one, so like, the pressure's off a little bit. But yeah, otherwise,
I know, I feel bad for Katsabella, whose episode's going to come out tomorrow as of recording, just like following up from Demo, which is an episode I could have had it for hours, but I thought, I've taken enough of your time and you're very busy and all that kind of stuff.
Demo was angry at me once. Right. This is a story. So like I got engaged in December, but like I have been married before because I'm an idiot. So, you know, second time, just a charm. But the first wedding, prior to that, back when I was just a young fan of the wrestling and not taking part in it, drunkenly asked Demo in a nightclub in Dundee if he wanted to come to my wedding, if him and Nikki wanted to come along, and he was all for it. And then I sobered up afterwards and was like, nah, you'll have been kidding. I won't actually. It'd be weird if I did send him an invite. And then the next time I saw him after I got married, he was like, you, I was maybe at your wedding. What the fuck happened? And he was like really annoyed by it. I was like, oh man, I'm so sorry. I didn't think. I mean, to be fair, like he lucked out. I wish I could have missed it. But yeah, Big Demo got annoyed because he didn't come to my wedding. That was a thing. Maybe right. I'll invite him to the next one.
So, Night with Damo and Cage, was that right? It could have been any because of it was Sunday, but was he sloshing in the middle of the dance floor?
We all were to Metallica. We started a slosh pit.
I was there that night. Yes. I didn't slosh. I just watched. Remember rightly? Oh, it was was it the Bret Hart one?
No, so, I mean, to be fair,
not the Bret Hart one. It wasn't at that one. Was it the Hell for Lycra that year, 2014?
I think so. So it was the one where he won the title in the three-way.
Yes.
Alan and John Lyons. Yes. And that bizarrely was not the main event, despite the fact that it should have been. And then the match after that was... Well, it was what it was.
It wasn't the match advertised, you know. Surprise, surprise.
But it's not like them. It's not like them to do that. What?
Not at all.
Where's Road Warrior Animal? What's happening?
Oh, I'm furious about that. And I know you brought that up.
That entire show, on my old Twitter profile, like my personal one, like there is a probably like 40 tweet long thread of just a rant about that show. But like I tweeted it like 3 or 4 years later because I was still angry and I was just talking about everything at that show that pissed me off.
that was the show that ended my affinity for that particular company. The show itself, I took it for what it was. I was still annoyed by it, but just the aftermath from all of it, it just killed my buzz for going down again.
I mean, I used to go to wrestling shows all throughout Scotland, like all the time. But quite a lot of the time, it'd be like over 18 shows I'd be going to and stuff. And my friend at the time, her kid loved wrestling and kept being like, "Oh, can I come wrestling with you?" And most of the time when I was going to wrestling, I was like, "No, you really can't." Then I saw like the Hell for Lycra was advertised, and I was like, "Do you know what? We'll all get tickets for it. Take the kid along," because the kid was like 7 or 8 or something, and was like wrestling. I was like, "Amazing! I'll take him to like his first live wrestling show. He'll love it. It'll be great." And then the first match that happened was a cage match where someone got like properly hung from the cage. Like, he's crying. He wants to go home. I'm like, mate, our train isn't for another 3 hours. You need to settle down. Like, this, I'm sorry. Yeah, this place is shit. But like,
do you like politics? See that yes flag that's getting spat on by the bad guy?
Yeah, because independence means babyface, and you know. Oh. Remain means it was a show.
Ambrose Stallion was good.
Yes, it was. And I got to meet Dennis Stamp. For like all the bad, like there have been some good things with that company. Like because of them, I got to meet Roddy Piper. So I'm like, amazing.
Got to meet DDP. That was good.
Chavo, Tatanka, you know, all these guys. I'm like, amazing. Like Dennis Stamp for me was like huge. I was so happy to be Dennis, and he was so happy to be there and see that people were like excited to see him. That was lovely. Everything else, like I was excited because there was a match advertised where I was like, "Oh my god, I'm actually going to get to see Johnny Saint wrestle." No, I'm not.
Oh, no. I thought you were going to mean Animal versus Demo because I was excited for that.
Yeah, I was excited for that. But then, like, clearly they were planning on wrestling. That's why he came out in a t-shirt and joggies and not ready to actually have a match. You know, like at least they kept the illusion of like, oh, the match was going to happen. Clearly, like, he was just waiting and then Damo got jumped, so he had to come and make the save. No, he's in like Sports Direct's finest. Like, they made no attempt to even, like, make it look like the match was going to happen. Right, no. I said the downer had stopped. This is me.
No, this is fun. I enjoy this one. I can join in. John the Bomb lost a shoe. You know,
the bomb lost the shoe. Right, that's a highlight though. That's one of the good things. Just seeing John the Bombers. The third Road Warrior. Just John. That was good. Bless it.
But no, yeah, everyone's favorite Marty Jones, coming out with Joe Hendry and then disappearing.
Yeah. It's like instead of it being like it was maybe Johnny Saint and with someone as a tag partner against Marty Jones and someone as a tag partner, and then it turned out they were just going to be managers, mm-hmm. and it was going to be
I remember four guys from Reckless.
Yeah, it was maybe Michael Chase and Johnny Saint against, I want to say it was like Marty Jones and Rollins or something.
That sounds right.
But then it wasn't. It was
Venom was in, I think, one of the teams.
And it got changed, and it was like, no, they're going to be the managers. And then Johnny stuck about, but then Marty's like, I'll manage behind the curtain by, like, I'll just go, hello, goodbye, yours in sport.
Oh, this anyone who's listened to this, after you listen to this episode, of course, all the way through, go back and listen to the Aspen Faith episode, because there is a Marty Jones story that has to be heard to believe. And then if you want to hear everything about it, go check out the Mosh Pit episode with Aspen as well, because Vago doesn't give a fuck and got the whole story out, because most of my story was outside of the recording, because it is wild, absolutely wild. Oh, that's that whole show. I was going to look up, but I realized I took off everything about that promotion off my site, so I can't find. I'd have to go into the drafts and go have a look for it and all that kind of stuff. But no, that review, that was the one that after that, and the video, of course, about just one of the guys didn't get paid. That was when I was getting threatened by
which one? Who? That's not like them either.
No,
people not getting paid.
What? Well, he had a day of celebration back in February, if that helps anyone's clues. He didn't get paid. February 14th, you know. And when I shared that was when I got threatened that my whole page was going to get shut down. I was going to get reported to Facebook and OSWTV would be no more. And then I just blocked him. And yeah. that was it forever. So there's your pick me up.
Yeah, I mean, at least, you know, they were only threatened to, like, take down your page, you know. It wasn't like they were going to set fire to anything or, like, cause any alarms.
Oh, references.
He's shooting. I don't care. I'm too old to get a contract in any major company. I don't give a fuck. Let's go for it.
I mean, it's not a major company anyway. Much of a difference.
I know, but, yeah.
It's all right. It's like, we're speaking of shootings. Like, I had three beers for my appearance on the Mosh Pit, and I was just going, I don't care. Like, everyone's getting shot on in this. And then came back for the award show, and I think I was just there to get taken the piss out of, because I won Loser of the Year, which is nice. And, well, sorry, Least Listened To Episode. That was the official title of it. Loser of the Year. And was there one I won? Moment of the Year, where they spent 3 minutes fucking roasting me. For reasons that it's fun, podcasting's fun. So yeah, so far I've really only asked you about episode 138. So let's try and maybe get our questioning.
Sure.
You got your first match. This is big. This is good positivity.
God, I don't know. We're like, how long into it? We're about half an hour in,
and now we're actually speaking about proper wrestling.
Had a wee debut ski.
You did. You were against John Kerr for Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum Showcase, Night 1, December 14th, 2021. Mm-hmm. How was it? When did you find out?
It was good. So, I didn't find out about when the showcase was going to be happening until about a month prior. But I knew that when the showcase was going to happen, that was the match that was going to happen, because at like a random sort of training session we had one night, we got told to like split off into twos and like come up with a match, and then we'd all do them at the end. Me and Kara paired off, and we clicked. Like, there's, I love working with Kara so much, because like we just seem to work really well together. So we had a match, and at the end of it, Andy like pulled us aside and was like, "That's good. When we have the showcase, I want that match." I think that was like the first match that got confirmed as, "When we have a showcase, that match is happening," which that was encouraging to hear. That was good. So found out about that. When we had the match at training, Craig Berry was not there for that session. And then when we found out that we were going to be having the showcase and that we'd need to like come up with matches, Craig was like, "Oh, maybe me and you, we could have a tag match." I was like, "I'm already booked, mate." Sorry. But yeah, so found out about that a wee while prior. And then when we found out the showcase was happening, we managed to like change a few things that we did. Like, we got given more time, got to add a few things in, take a few things out, like tweak things. And then the end of like the match that came out, we got good feedback on it. We thought, like, from what we've heard from people, like, was a good match. Like, for a debut, I was happy with it. But then that was my first match. And then I had my second match 2 days later. That came about because one of the guys that was meant to be in the match ended up getting COVID. So he had to pull out, and Andy was like, "Do you want to wrestle twice? Would you be able to like jump in here?" And I was like, "Yeah, okay, cool." That was because like when guys were practicing matches, a lot of the time Kara would be at work, so we couldn't practice our match. So I was just stood there like filling in for bodies that weren't at that training session. So I'd already like worked in that tag match as Craig's partner because Redfield wasn't there that training session, and then got asked if I could take someone else's place on the other team, and I was like, "Yeah, okay, cool. I kind of already know all the spots." So then I got two matches instead of one, which was fun.
Yeah, I mean, absolute bonus. I mean, the match with John then. So the one John Kerr is on YouTube. You put it out on YouTube.
Yes, and all put that out. Put that one out because I won. I'm not going to put out the other one. I lost. Like, I'm not an idiot.
Did you find that maybe, did John come with a lot of ideas? Because the two of you, of course, he's had matches before.
Yeah.
Even though, again, they were in Dundee. So there's a argument to say they didn't count.
But for even for like the matches he had, they were good. Like, I've seen it, like, boy can work. And then I think he had wrestled for FCW as well when they started having shows
pre-pandemic. Yeah, as well. I think he did some W3L shows as well. So the guy, he's had a good few matches in his time.
He's been about.
so is he kind of guy that kind of like not try to pull the vet card on you, but like, is he able to kind of just guide you a bit more and that make you more comfortable for your first match?
Yeah, I think so. I think when we started off the first match we had in the training session, we only got given about like 5 minutes. We ended up getting like triple that for the showcase. We got like told like between 12 to 15. But because it was so short, like, we came up with like a few spots we wanted to do, and he was able to like sort of fill in the wee things around it. And then it helped as well that he worked heel for it. So he was able to sort of direct most of it during the match. But I don't, like, we knew what we were doing, so there wasn't really any bits where we're like, any one of us lost our place, but if like nerves happen, it was good to know that like he's been there, so he'd be able to help steer it back in the right direction.
And I think a lot of I think I can't remember what I was listening to. I think it was maybe a Jeff Jarrett podcast, but it's getting that bits in the middle. It's doing the moves, but it's just getting that transitions in the middle kind of down. was it him? Something about a Stephen Amell match that they were watching and said that it was the match. He's got all the moves down, but he just needs to to flow them together, and then he would be ace or something like that. But yeah, so yeah, first match in, and then of course thrown into this second one just not last minute because you kind of knew what was going on anyway. Yeah. But it was last minute at the same time.
It was good. I knew going into it that I wasn't going to win, so I was like, well, I want something out of it. So because I think Redfield had put a promo out already about how it was going to be him and Craig against Maverick and Doc Proc, who I ended up taking his place because he had mentioned Doc Proc and that. I was like, all right, cool. It hasn't been announced that he's out of it. So I asked Andy if it would be okay if Craig and Redfield come out and then Maverick comes out and then nothing. And so it acts like he's not got a partner. Then lights go out, my music starts, and I get like the big surprise, like I'm here to save the day pop. I got that. I was allowed to do that. So I was like, all right, cool. I'll get that. That's fine. I get something. Get a wee cheap pop for coming to save the day. That was good. Also, the second night there was more kids in the crowd, which I found was a lot better. It's a lot of fun wrestling in front of like kids that get really into the matches and are like shouting abuse at the heels, and that was fun.
Just you wait until we get you go into like W3L tours and you get the inflatable hammers out. They're merciless. They go wild for, like I think I've said in the past, maybe in the Mike Musso episode, I've seen a child chase a wrestler with the claw end of an inflatable hammer, and it's terrifying to watch. I don't like them anyway, but that's just...
I think it was last weekend. Was it last weekend, I think? When the community pro wrestling show was happening in Govan.
Right.
Craig was helping set up and do ring crew and that, and he was telling me some horror stories about what the kids from Govan are like. I was like, I can't wait for that. Yes, I am all for rowdy children shouting abuse and trying to hurt people. Like, that's dream audience.
Fueled on sugar and whatever else is going on in Govan. I mean, I don't want to speculate. I've never been. But no, it's from what I've seen on the YouTube, it is a wild crowd at those shows. And I can just fully imagine that they've gone wilder now that Ravy Davy is booking the territory, I suppose.
Yes.
We'll call it. So you changed your look a little bit for your debut match.
Of course, yes.
So that people can see it a little bit in the video.
Partly because of the aforementioned mental breakdown. You know, when people go to mental, they dye their hair. It all started because Gene Money put out a tweet a while back saying that 90% of the guys in British wrestling are bald with a beard. And I was like, fuck, I need to do something. So I started growing my hair out a bit. I bleached it. I dyed it a sort of luminous yellow green. It glows under UV light, which is like, yeah, that's a sight. But so it's looking a bit better now than it was. It was very...
It was neon. Very... It was like a Coldplay song. Very yellow.
Yes, yeah. It was. But no, now I've shaved the sides a bit, but it's still long at the back. It's not quite a mohawk and it's not quite a mullet. It's somewhere in between. It's a mulhawk, or I don't know. But it's going all right. I've got some more dye to like redo the colour a bit. Because I think I'm going to keep it that way. It goes with the whole sort of punk vibe. But yeah, it's a bit different. I need to get new promo pictures because the ones I have now are terribly out of date. They're all shaved-headed.
Yeah, I had to go right dig to find one to put on the thumbnail. So thank you for Chris Farrell for doing a photo shoot with you, because I was able to use that one. So I was like, right, I was going to use one of your old ones, but I thought it's going to look really weird when your bald head, beard,
and you'd asked, I'd have taken one for you, but like you should have got a special one.
I know, it's one of those weird requests. I don't like asking people because it just sounds really creepy. I don't know. Sure,
I'm surprised you didn't use the Day of Earth Bonanza picture, really, but
you didn't have the hair, and that was just, that was the. It's still saved on my phone.
I'll redo it. I'll take it.
so yeah, I'll put that one up. But I remember that tweet now from Gene. Yes. Someone who's not in the wrestling business, I looked at it and went, oh no, I'm that as well. And
it deeply affected me more than it probably should have. I saw it and I was like, shit, yeah, because like everyone is trying to be like different. Everyone's trying to have like a sort of unique selling point compared to other wrestlers where it's like, well, this one's not like this one. I'm like, oh yeah, no, fuck, I am just a bald guy with a beard, am I?
You're the fat, dad bod guy lying down, you're that meme.
Yes, that was my fishbulb moment. That happened. I recreated the picture. It's me. That is me. Like, the guy in the picture has, like, he's got swallow tattoos in the exact same place where I have swallow tattoos. It, like, that is a picture of me. Someone found me and drew me. Like, when this comes out, I'll tweet a picture so that the people listening can see. But, like, yeah. Like, it was scary when I first saw that picture.
I mean, it could be worse. I'm the fat guy in the water slide gif that slides across the screen, because every time I looked at it and go, when did I go on a water slide? Because it goes past too fast. You don't see tattoos or anything on him. You just see a fat bald guy just go across the screen. I'm like, that's what I look like. And that is haunting to see every time, because I've used it enough now. It's one of my most popular gifs on Twitter. So it's the first thing I see if I look for a GIF on Twitter now, and it's just like, yeah, I should lose weight, but I like food too much to.
Yeah, I have that issue. Like, especially with the whole like mental decline and not be like, I have put on some weight that I really need to shift, but I do love eating so much. I need to try and find the balance where I'm working off more than what I'm putting in, which is a tricky thing. Like, I do the whole calorie counting thing, but I think my numbers are off because it's not quite working just now. Although I haven't been able to exercise a lot recently. Like, I've been off training for the last month because I had an operation, and I had like a scar. I'm still waiting on, like, I should be fine to like go back to training next week, I think. It seems to be looking okay, but like I've done nothing but just sit and eat for the last month and a bit, and I am not quite in the ring shape I was.
Is there a party that sometimes rationalize it and go, I'm bulking up, I'll lean it out?
Or
yeah, that's, I mean, at least you're in a place where there's a lot of guys in FPWA that have done that. I mean, like Andy, of course. Jason Reed's doing that at the moment, I think, as well.
Jason Reed is in too good shape. Like, no one should look that good. Same with Caleb. Like, looking at them makes me sad. Like, I have to train with them, and it's just, like, it hurts to look at.
Yeah,
they're like great to wrestle with, but it just hurts to look at.
Yeah, I'm the same with Caleb. When he's up here wrestling, I look at him and go, because like, where is your flaws, man? There's just none. I and then you meet him and he's nice. I'm like, oh, just be a dick.
Yeah. Like, Lauren had like seen pictures of him on like online. Lauren's my fiance. She had seen like pictures online and stuff but she saw him like in person at a disco show and was just like, he's not real. That's how
Yeah, Kelly.
How can he look like that? And I'm like, yeah, I don't know, but it's yeah.
Yeah, that's the, Kelly's got the same kind of reaction, and like I say, the nice thing as well, just like how just no, if you're gonna look that good, be a dick. don't be nice.
Like at least yeah.
Anyway, and we're just gonna wander off and just imagine Caleb Valhalla, which is
it's not a bad thing.
I mean,
right, hang on, I've been scrolling. I found the meme. That's me. That is me. I don't know how, but someone found me and drew me.
Yeah, so for those that are wondering, you can't really see it, but yeah, my frequently yeah. used GIF. There is me going across the screen. I mean, some of us have to look that way. It makes guys like Caleb and Jason look even better. That's the gift we give.
See, right, hang on.
This is a great audio content.
I know, I feel bad for the people that are just listening on like Spotify or Apple Music or anywhere you may get your good
there we go.
There's the podcast run. So there's the picture there. And here is me. Like recreate, it's me. That is just someone drew this before I took the photo somehow. It's a fish bulb, you know. It's like the episode of The Simpsons where Homer finds his face on the box of Mr. Sparkle.
Yeah,
and it's like, why is it me? It's like, no, it's a fish in a light bulb. I'm like, no, that's my fish bulb.
So I'm with the meme lord here. Meme lord, no, I think that's probably that sounds a bit more doesn't sound as good. But no, I can't even think of the words. It's you know, I'm blaming Caleb. He's discombobulated my brain here. So yeah, so you had your first matches. Yeah, you had the tag team match as well. So after you had that, have you like gotten the bug a little bit more for it? Is it now just every time Andy brings up possibly if matches go on, you kind of just pop up from behind and go,
hello,
I can do a match. Hello, yeah. Like, who do you want me to face?
Yeah, definitely. I've so the match with Kerr, I've sent it to a few different people, asking for their feedback, on like where I can improve and stuff like that. And from the people that I've sent it to so far that I've had responses from, most of the feedback's been really good. There's been like little things that I've been told that I can like change, but the overall feedback to that match has been positive, which makes me just want to go do more. It won't be too long until I'm on another show somewhere, or like there's another showcase. I've spoken to a few people that there's possibilities possibly popping up at some point, but nothing's confirmed, so I don't want to jinx myself, touch wood. But yes, definitely got the bug. It's like nothing else. Like I don't know what I thought going into it. Like I knew that I wanted to be a wrestler, but like actually being on a show with a crowd and like having the crowd be engaged, like I wasn't prepared for it. It's a very addictive, so I definitely want to get that again, definitely soon, like not have to wait too long until I can do that again.
And it must be kind of like, as well as that, you're seeing guys, of course, the Discovery, you're seeing Frank Gallo, Tommy Cartel, yes. Beth Shorty as well. They made their Discovery debut. You've got Harmony Sky appearing in WWE on the network, and for ICW, Robbie Balfour and Ross Hunter, and
yeah,
two Harness guy's popped up at Pro 2 as well. Guy's coming up this end of the time with Omar Mohammed now up in the Northeast. And of course, Caleb's everywhere because he's fucking Caleb.
Why wouldn't you want him on a show? Any promoter that looks at Caleb and is like, nah, I'll get someone else, like, shouldn't be booking a show.
Being able to see these guys that are starting to venture out, that must be kind of encouraging for you to go, right, that's fine. If they can do it, then I've got a shot of being able to wrestle it. I mean, I know Discovery is probably your kind of top tier where you want to be.
I think so, yeah. Like Discovery, I've been around Discovery since like the beginning of Discovery, since like before they were having shows and they just announced they were going to be a company when they had like a viewing party for WrestleMania 30 in a Dundee student union. So like literally from like day one, I've been a fan of Disco. So like that is definitely a goal. But I'd quite like to travel about. Like I'd like to work. Well, I'd like to work anywhere. Book me. But I'd quite like to like work my way up to that, I think. I'd quite like to travel around and have matches elsewhere and like maybe build up to get into that point. I don't think I'm quite there. Like I know I'm not quite there yet. But hopefully with like a bit more experience like in other places can get there.
Be the Fair City Hooligan and Fair City Wrestling, you know, that kind of stuff. There's some companies that are running again that maybe shouldn't be. They'll remain nameless. But there's still plenty of opportunities just in this country itself. I mean, of course, England's just across the border, whether we like it or not. But it's across the border and there's plenty of places there.
I don't get the whole hate on England. I like England. Like
I don't hate them either. It's just sometimes fun to do.
I like the English people. I don't really care for the English government, but I don't think it's fair to like link the two. They're not.
No.
Yeah.
It's I think it's more the media that I dislike in general, because this is was it last year that with the World Cup Euros? I don't know. I don't care. And it was the first time that I didn't actually actively despise the England team, because the media just were a bit quiet about it. And like, then they got to the final. I was like, oh, you've done it again, you media pricks. You've ruined it for me. I was quite enjoying this tournament.
Like I get grief for like when there's a football tournament on. Like I don't actively support against England. Like I would have liked it if they had won last year at the. Was it the Euros?
The Euros.
Yeah, because it was meant to be Euro 2020, but then it got postponed, so they had to hold it in 2021 instead. I don't even watch football, so I don't...
I literally watched the tournament because Scotland were in it, and then they didn't last long, so...
Yeah. We'd put it on for, like, the guys that I supported that were, like, into football, and they had a wall chart of, like... all the teams and having the matches and that, and then no other staff member really cared enough to update it, so like I was in every day like saying like, all right, they won against that, the score was, so like I by fluke kept up with the tournament all the way up to the final, and I kind of got into it, like not I'm still not like a football fan by any means, but I kind of got into it and I kind of wanted England to win because I was like, it'd be nice for them, and like the guys on the squad seemed nice. There was that, is it Marcus Rashford was doing all that stuff for like kids to get like free school dinners and that.
It's probably, you know, probably like, the most palatable team in years.
If there was ever like a team where it's like, it'd be nice if they had won it, you know, and like, I don't get the whole grief from him. So.
Speaking of those wall charts, there's a Chinese around the corner from us that still has the Japan and South Korea World Cup 2002 wall chart on their window, and it still tickles me every time I see it, because they've got bunting as well. They've got World Cup 2002 bunting, and every time I go in, I go, this is, well, now I'm going in every time I go, that's 20 years old. That. I'm looking at it. 20 years old.
Fucking hell. I feel sick. No.
I was 12 when that happened. To be 12 again when I had hair. And my teeth were straight because I didn't fall off my bike and smash my face against pavement. You know, it was a wonderful time.
Straight teeth are overrated.
These have got a story. Stupidity, but a story nonetheless. This is probably one of my favorite podcasts so far, just because we have not really stuck to anything and we found a subject and have just went, who cares about wrestling? Let's speak about something else entirely.
This has just been rambling. I love it.
It's often the best way.
Yes.
We'll dive into the two questions that we got on one, and then we got a reply. So I think they're both worthy of being discussed. So of course, first one being Adam Morrison, head writer. I call him head writer because I don't like doing writing. So that's why he's the head writer of the website. Although I've started doing it again, and I don't mind it, but I like this. I like this interaction and stuff to speak about wrestling. Anyway, he's asked, the Extreme Elimination Chamber match is actually a great concept and should be brought back. Discuss.
I have somewhat of a reputation of being a fan of ECW December to Dismember 2006,
I was gonna say you don't need to add the extra bit, do you? Because
there was a December to Dismember in like, I think it was like 90th.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there was like it wasn't like a big pay-per-view thing but it was an event they held. But yeah, I have this reputation of speaking of old, and it being too thick, I felt horrible when I realized that December just passed was the 15-year anniversary of it. And I was like, oh no, that's bad. I feel so I'm blaming Frank from Last Minute Wrestling Podcast for starting this because he initially started slagging off Great American Bash. I think it was 2005, and I was like,
whoa, hang on. Was that main event Lashley Cena?
No.
That was 2006, wasn't it? Great American Bash.
Was it 2004? It was the one where the main event was Undertaker against the Dudley Boys, and then Paul Bearer ended up getting...
I think that was 04. Double check. Just for
him. Sure,
the
one up here. Yes, 2000.
Yes, it was 2004.
Yes.
We had the Texas Bullrope match between JBL and Eddie Guerrero, where just everyone pissed blood for a bit.
He was sliding off like the Great American Bash, and I was like, hey, no, don't do that.
That's a great show.
Was it 2005?
Suzuki versus Billy Gunn. How can you slag off a show that has that match on it?
What was the one that had did it have like the debut of Mordecai as well?
Yes, it did.
Or something. It was like, yep. So I took a picture of myself with that DVD and was like, please do not speak badly of my son. acting like it was my child. And he was like, well, Indivet is probably just like the second worst pay-per-view of all time. And I was like, right, what do you think is the first? And he was like, ECW December to Dismember. And so I took a picture of that DVD. I was like, don't you dare speak badly of this. And so I got this ECW December to Dismember was a good show with flaws. It does not deserve the hate that it gets. But the Extreme Elimination Chamber is one of the worst ideas ever conceived because it makes two negatives, because by putting weapons inside an elimination chamber, it's like they're saying that the chamber itself isn't enough, which then sort of ruins the reputation of the chamber match in general. And then also, ECW as a brand like, it should have been presented as, like, these guys are so extreme that they don't need an elimination chamber to cause this much damage on one another. So, like, they shouldn't have had an elimination chamber match in the first place. Like, it shouldn't have happened. However, working within that flaw, it was still a good show. There were problems with it, as there are with many events, but, like, I will go down saying that, like, it does not deserve the hate that it gets. But no, the Elimination Chamber, the Extreme Elimination Chamber match should not be brought back. It was detrimental to Elimination Chambers in general and to ECW, or what they were trying to make ECW be. It was wrong.
I disagree. I think it'll still work. I think they could make it work. I get your point. I'll take your point as it wasn't right for ECW. I'll say that's right, because when it's supposed to be the third brand, it's supposed to be looking at the redhead stepchild. Apologies to all gingers out there, but they shouldn't be able to afford an elimination chamber. So I'll give it that.
In canon, with WWE storylines, if you're following it, which I don't think the writers do, but technically, the Elimination Chamber match was created by Eric Bischoff. So why have a match created by Eric Bischoff, you know, in canon, appear on an ECW show? I don't agree with that. Like, that shouldn't have happened.
I think what they should have done was bring back Kennel from Hell.
The main event of that match should have been the match between Daivari and Tommy Dreamer.
You're just ignoring my point there. Fine, that's okay. You don't want to talk about Kennel from Hell. That's okay.
I do think they should bring back Kennel from Hell. I don't think it should have been at December to Dismember, but I do think it's about time for Kennel from Hell to...
Right. Speaking of terrible stipulations, then two came into my mind. Then we were speaking about Extreme Elimination Chamber. What could possibly have maybe replaced it? First one that came to mind was I can't remember what it was called. It was JBL Big Show barbed wire steel cage
match from No Way Out.
Yeah, that one where JBL won because he was choke slammed through the canvas and he crawled under the apron. Spoilers, people.
Genius.
Amazing. Yeah. That would have been quite cool. Again, Kennel from Hell. Have it the Hell in the Cell. Have the barbed wire steel cage in the middle. Could have still done pods. It would have worked. The other one was just ripping off TNA and doing Lethal Lockdown.
Yeah. Like, I thought that, like, because ECW had done, like, back when there was actual ECW, they had done, like, War Games matches before. It was called, like, Ultimate Jeopardy, where, like, it was like a War Games match, but everyone that was going into it had, like, a stipulation. So, like, whoever got pinned, something happened to them. Like, I can't remember. I remember, like, the Eliminators were in it, and at one point in one team, and if one of them got pinned, then the team had to break up. Like, everyone had, like, a sort of stipulation. So I thought they could have brought that back, since the whole storyline with December Dismember was that, like, Paul Heyman had turned mental and started loving the Big Show and had got the Basham brothers in biker helmets for some reason. Like, they could have had, like, like a sort of ECW team against a Paul Heyman team, and that would have made sense. Because half the time, like, with old ECW pay-per-views, people complained about December Dismember because they were like, oh, there's only two matches advertised going into it. That's normally, like, about the same or more as what you used to get with original ECW pay-per-views, and you would show up and not know what matches were going to happen. And you just, like, they would just make the match up on the night. So that was on brand. Like, I feel like that wasn't a big deal. They could have, like, yeah, if I was in, I could have rebooked it. Like, that's a whole other podcast.
I mean,
but
I think,
again, it still should have been main evented by Daivari against Tommy Dreamer. Like, that whole rivalry was wasted. Like, that could have been so much more. I will defend that with every fiber of my being.
I think we can both agree, though, that Tesh should have been ECW champion at some
yes.
point. There we go.
Tesh, like, if they were going to do the chamber match, like, Tesh should have won it. Like, people were saying, like, CM Punk, Rob Van Dam, Test would have been perfect.
Give me Test Lashley at the Rumble, and then that could have been the title change there. Test. Because Test should have been, I mean, he did the whole elbow drop off the top of the pod with the chair and everything. It was just Test.
That brief bit where Test was in ECW was amazing. Like, people shit all over WWE ECW, but it has so many, like, great moments in it. I mean,
he was definitely a wellness violation. He was a walking wellness violation, but, you know, it looked amazing. So, you got to take it rough with the smooth sometimes, that kind of stuff. But no, I loved Test last run in WWE. It was just great. He didn't give a shit. He just came in and battered folk, and it was like, yes, I will take this.
What you want? That's what you should have been all along. Like, yeah.
I do remember having a Test action figure, and he had these silver pleather trousers, and it takes a lot to be able to carry that, but Test is able to carry silver pleather trousers, no bother, with his weird cross symbol, which I never understood what it was or what it was for. But yeah, so.
I think it was maybe like a T for Test.
Yeah, but there was like a moon, but, and there was some Celtic stuff going on, and I don't think Tess knew, to be honest.
It did the job. It looked cool.
So, I mean, if you're learning anything from this podcast, is we're definitely a couple testicles.
Yes.
We started the show talking about Muff, and now we're talking about testicles. So, you know, you're well into the explicit.
All comes around full circle, yeah.
Exactly. Two full circles, so to speak. Right, what can we actually speak about this rest? Anyway, the other one.
Yes.
Chris Farrell also wanted to bring up to discuss the championship scramble match.
Yes. That's something that would have worked in ECW. Yeah. I loved the championship scramble. It was such like a good idea.
I think it would work now.
I feel like what they do now, like leading up to the Elimination Chamber matches where they have like the gauntlet match where it's everyone that's in the match and then whoever ends up winning it in the last match ends up like the last person to come out of the chamber. Like, they could easily change that to a scramble where so that it's not just like singles matches. Although like the gauntlet matches that we have been had recently have been like, they've been really good, like probably better than they had any right to be. I remember the one where it was the like Seth Rollins running through like every, that was a great year where they did that. But the championship, it like, I don't know why they don't still use that. That was such a great concept.
I mean, if anything, you could gauge the fans' reaction. So imagine last year they did it, did it with Roman was defending, and for 5 minutes Cesaro was the champion until, and then you could have gauged what the fans thought at that point. Could they have him as champion? I mean, there's things from a promoter standpoint that could work for them, and then at the end Roman could have just choked someone out in the last minute.
Yes,
no harm, no foul, and he's still the champ. So
plus you get like the meme value of it as well from like where you get the screenshot of like current WWE champion Brian Kendrick. Like you can do that if
he's still dining on that, I think. Well, I mean
he's not dining on much else.
No, he's not. I was gonna say that's all you can hope you can find when you Google him, but no, you don't. You find other things, and that was a wild week. I mean, as of recording now, we've got like Cody Rhodes about and not about, and we've got Ring of Honor being purchased, which is a big news when there's nothing there to purchase, really, except a tape library. And I don't know, but, you know.
I mean, they've got Joe Hendry. Like,
if they've got Joe Hendry to a contract, I'm interested.
Worth the money alone. Like, I'd buy Ring of Honor if it meant I had Joe Hendry on my company. Like, not me just now, personally. I have no money. but, yeah, if I had the funds that Tony Khan did, like, that makes perfect sense. Like, I'll buy Ring of Honor just to have Joe on my shows.
But that's, I mean, we're talking about stuff that's happening now as of recording when this won't go out for another few weeks. Yeah. But I will promise you, I'll promise Tony Khan, if he's watching this, if you put Joe Hendry on your show on actual Dynamite, don't fob me off with Dark or Elevation. If you put Joe Hendry on Dynamite, I will watch Dynamite. I don't watch it at the moment. I just don't. But if you put Joe Hendry on, if you give me Joe Hendry versus Bryan Danielson, I will subscribe to your YouTube, sir. You know, just saying. So Tony, if you're listening, if you've got past the meme chat, if you got past the December to Dismember stuff, which you probably loved, if you got past all that, book it. Danielson, Hendry. Thumbs up. I will watch.
Or book me.
Or yeah, triple threat.
I am available. I don't know if I will be by the time this recording comes out, but I do. I am available.
I'll build your card for you, Tony. We've got Brent Carter and John Moxley. We've got Danielson, Hendry. You know,
just put us all in a scramble match.
Scramble, yeah, exactly. Put in. Who else can you put in?
Who's TNT champion?
I don't know what Sammy Guevara on the show. Let's get someone else. Sting. Put Sting. Why not? CM Punk. Let's put him in.
Just throw Punk in there.
To be honest, when he was feuding with MGF, which probably will still be going when this comes out, what else was he doing?
It's good, like it's good stuff just now. Like it's a good time to be a wrestling fan.
Mm-hmm. There's plenty of choice. That's the best thing. If you don't like one thing, unfortunately, I think people forget that on the old Twitter sphere and all that kind of stuff. There's choice. If you don't have to watch everything, I watch WWE. That's what I like. That's what I watch. I don't watch much else outside of this country, of course. But no, that's just what I like.
If it's not funded by Saudi Arabia blood money, Billy does not watch it. That is what we have learned.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, everything's blood money eventually. America. Yeah. It's America as well. It's all blood money at the end of the day.
Yeah. Sorry.
I mean, even British shows, we can say that there's an empire way back when. It's still self-funded by stuff, you know. This is possible stuff that'll get cut.
I'm definitely not getting any sort of contract.
Let's just stop that conversation here now. So we've had the diner section. This is the ranty section and when this comes out, I'll forget I ever said any of this. And
you know, things are bad when WWE's cancelled like all of their shows airing in Russia and not letting Russia have access to the WWE network. When like they'll have shows in Saudi Arabia. Like, you know Russia's fucked up. Like, Jesus. If Vince is this angry, you've done something.
I mean, we say all the stuff about the Saudi stuff. As soon as WWE put SummerSlam or that into the UK, we're all going to be buying tickets. So, you know. So you have to kind of, it's like we were saying right at the start with more serious things. You just find, you have to find the positives, because if you don't, then you're not going to like anything. You're not going to do anything. You've got to try and find some glimmer of hope, I suppose, at the end of all.
And I can be your glimmer of hope if you book me.
Exactly. You can, what's that song? You can be, no, now I've just got Sure Believe in my head. Let's just move on. I can be your, anyway. So.
Is that not Enrique Iglesias?
No, it's not. I could, right, I'm
Googling. I thought you were singing Hero.
It wasn't what I was going for. I can
watch in, though, by the way.
Speaking of heroes, I was enjoying the resurgence of Chad Kroeger and Josie Scott last year when Spider-Man came out.
What a segue.
I know. I Can Be Your Father Figure. That's the song I'm thinking of. George Michael, Father Figure.
Oh, I don't have one of those, so like, sure.
I think it was just a tune. I'm now just looking at the lyrics and it made no sense to my point at the time. So we'll just, like I say, I think we'll just move on. Savio Vega.
Yes.
That seems like a good way to absolutely...
100%.
180%.
Like, why were people disappointed that he was the fourth man for that like 8-man tag match at No Way Out? Like, why? Like... Surprise Savio Vega sounds like the best sort of Savio Vega to me. Imagine not thinking you were going to see Savio Vega wrestle and then all of a sudden, hey, look, Savio Vega. Like, how can anyone be disappointed by that?
I don't know. I just wrote down, literally, when I wrote down my notes, I put, like, put your matches, I put yellow hair, and I put Savio Vega. That is literally all I wrote down for this, and we're over an hour in. And
why Savio Vega?
I don't know. I think it's because, right, I was doing my wee research. I came across your episode with Jason Hyde. Jason Hyde tries to socialize
with like the worst audio quality.
It wasn't ever. The best, in fairness, no. But I cannot judge because some of the stuff, I mean, some of the audio quality I've put out has been questionable at the best of times. Not just because of the content and all the stuff that I speak about, but you know, it is what it is.
So he did his for Skype instead of Zoom. Like these were like I'm completely set up for Zoom. I hadn't used Skype for anything like that in God knows how long. So I had to re-download it. And like in the settings, I hadn't changed for like the audio input to be from this lovely off-screen microphone. And it had it set where it was going to pick up the audio from the webcam itself, which is like a tiny little so like I couldn't hear myself back, so I didn't know there was a problem until the show went out. And I was like, oh, man, if anyone managed to sit the whole way through that, they are stronger than it. Yeah, that was, I felt bad. Chatting about was great, but the audio quality, I couldn't have sat through that.
I did, but that's just because I was all in on the Jason Hyde Express, and I'm disappointed we don't have any more, but hopefully we get more in the future. But no, I and you'd had a very in-depth chat through the buzz of about Savio Vega. So that's
why I wrote down. Jason did reply to a tweet I put out saying that he was thinking about bringing back the podcast just to talk about that tweet. So it may happen. We may get a part two at some point. I'd put a tweet out. Someone had posted something like, oh, what are like your most, was it like most embarrassing injuries or something like that? And so I just made a thread of like a whole bunch of mine of like how I ended up like getting concussion from going down the vert ramp at a skate park whilst inside a wheelie bin. Like a bunch of like different things that like I broke my foot because I was having a wrestling match in my bedroom against an Ultimate Warrior wrestling buddy, like you know those stuffed toy things. I was having a ladder match against one of them. I'd put like I had a belt not completely unlike the Day of Birth Bonanza Championship hanging from like the light fitting in my bedroom, and there's a ladder in my room because there was like pipes in there that someone was fixing. They'd left the ladder there. So I was like, well, I'm going to have a ladder match against my wrestle buddy. I fell off the ladder and landed on my foot badly and broke my foot. My mum didn't believe I broke my foot because like the next day I had an exam at school and she was like, nah, you're still going to school. And I was like, all right. So I had to like walk to school, had my exam. And then by the end of the exam, like she came to pick me up and I couldn't walk. And I was like, please take me to the hospital now. And she was like, oh shit, okay, you do have a broken foot. It's like, yeah, thanks. So like there was a whole bunch of that. And then like the last one was about how I had bruised my penis because it got slammed inside a freezer door. And then Jason was like, yeah, I might need to bring back the podcast so we can chat about that. But I put in it, like, I'll be taking no questions at this time. So, yeah.
I have questions, but I think I'll leave that for Jason to explore.
There's not a lot to explain, like...
Was it on purpose?
Yeah, so, like, in... I want to say, like, in our, like, teenage years, like, me and a few of my friends thought, like, it'd be fun to, like, film Jackass-type behaviour between us. It was all terrible. Like, there's, like, footage of me, like, getting set on fire. We did this one bit where, like, guys were, like, putting their head inside a fridge freezer, and someone else was just like slamming the door on their head, and like that had happened a bunch of times, and it got to me, and then I did it, and I was like, I didn't seem that bad, and everyone else was like, ah, and they're like, oh, all right, we'll put your dick in it then. I was like, okay, I may have been drunk.
I would like to hope so, to be honest. Yeah. The story.
Yeah. So then. Freezer door slammed, and that, yeah, which, yeah, may explain why it stopped growing after that, but it might be why, like, the Day of Birth Bonanza Championship was fine from any sort of sacrilege.
it wasn't getting tipped anytime soon.
Gonna blame it on that.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's Savio Vega.
I don't know how we went from Savio Vega to getting your cock stuck in or slammed in a fridge, but here we are. I mean, mine aren't that embarrassing. I mean, I split my head trying to do a wheelie. That was fun. Broke my teeth trying to do another wheelie. That was another time. I wasn't very good at wheelies. I was very evident of that because I kept having face and head injuries. Of course, everyone knows how I broke my arm. If you don't, I've mentioned it in so many podcasts now. It's a ridiculous story. Shouldn't have happened as a 21-year-old. It was a thing. It happened. But no, that's about it.
There's a few others. Like, I can't remember all the ones I put in the tweet. I know that I got my tailbone broken because I was in town. And my friend saw me from like a distance away and was near a traffic cone. So decided to pick up the traffic cone, put it on his crotch and run full force towards me. I wasn't facing him. I didn't know this was happening. So he saw the back of me and was like, oh, that's Brent. Kayfabe. I just ran full force and I got a traffic cone like right on my arse and it broke my tailbone. That one's in there. I don't know if it, like, I've cracked my head open doing a Swanton bomb. Swanton bomb in quotation marks, like Dr. Evil, for those that cannot see the video, because it was not a Swanton bomb. That was in the common room at school. So when we were in sixth year, we started a wrestling fed at school. And the ring was made up of, there was a wall of lockers on one side, and then we just set chairs around in like a sort of square shape around the other way. So there was no ropes, it was just tables and lockers and then like hard wooden floor. So I decided to climb onto the table, climb from the table up onto the top of the lockers and do a swanton. Basically just fell on my head. Cracked my head open. There's a bunch of, yeah, like I've had some trips to A&E. Yeah.
I mean I know you tried e-fedding as well.
That was
one half of the Rent Boys. I remember that
from now, the Rent Cup. Boys was that wasn't
was, that was but not that wasn't e-fedding, was it?
That was legit gimmick, yeah. I mean, there was a bit of virtual as well. Like we made the two of us on SmackDown Just Bring It, and we used to play it on the PlayStation at his house at lunchtime because he lived next to school. So there was a bit of a virtual element to that. But no, the Rent Boys was a legit thing.
Every point when we're going through these things, that there is a point where you're going, I've lived a life.
So I just really, anyone that hasn't seen like that clip from the Wrestling Daft podcast won't know what the fuck I'm talking about and just be like, what the fuck is Brent voice? I don't know whether I want to tell it or if I just leave it there.
I mean, we like the guys at Wrestling Daft. You can go find the episode. Yeah. Listen to all of them and you'll find it.
That story, just my story on its own, was clipped because that was special enough to make its own little video. So it's easy enough to find. That is my claim to fame in wrestling. Like nothing I've done through like online or in actual match. Like that is my wrestling claim to fame. Just that story. I don't know how I feel about it. That and the Shawn Michaels photo. I don't do myself any favors, do I? Like, I'm never, not surprised.
Never a dull moment. That's the positive spin we could put on this as well. Yeah. Never a dull moment in the world of Brent Carter. Yeah, we'll go with that. But no, I remember also you teased me that there was a question appeared on Shagmar Annoyed that was anonymous.
Yes.
It has been brought up and answered on an episode of Chris and Rosie Ramsey's podcast, Shagmar Annoyed.
Do you want to know which one it is? Please don't hang on. I don't want it to be the shower story. Wait, actually, hang on. I'm going to kill for time. I'm going to message Lauren and see if she's okay with me telling the story on this podcast. Okay. The beauty of Shagmar Annoyed was that it was anonymous.
Mm-hmm.
So, like...
Did you go see them live when they were doing their
No. I think because like the whole COVID thing, I wasn't keeping up to date with like what live events were actually happening and what were. No. I think Lauren wanted to go when it was like first announced they were going to be doing stuff like that, and then because was it a stage show or was it like a book tour? Because I know
it was a stage show. We went to the Aberdeen one, and it was just a riot. It was an absolute riot. It was so much fun. Definitely worth going to if you could have went. But no, speaking of stories, there's always one story that brings me the fear, and I hope it's not this. I doubt it is, because I think you kind of told me a little bit what genre the story is.
Mm.
But the story that always gives me the fear and makes me actually a little bit woozy is women getting their nipple ring put in, and they went for a shower and saw what they thought was a hair and clipped it, and then woke up in the shower because they'd clipped a nerve ending and passed out.
that's grim. I've had my nipples pierced, and I've had in sleep, like, it's not been that bad, but like I have like tweaked it before, and that wasn't fun. I ended up losing my nipple piercing just on a walk home once, and I have no idea how. I was at a birthday party at someone's house, and it was like, I want to say it was like 40 miles away from Perth, and then ended up walking home drunk with some other guy, and at some point on the trip from there to Perth, like it came out, don't know where, don't know when, but God knows. She's messaged back. I'm allowed to tell the story.
Yes. I think this will be, we'll make this our finale. We might speak about like dream matches afterwards, so we actually speak about wrestling to end off with. But yep, I mean, what was it?
Right. So I'll tell it. Right. So Lauren, my fiance, bless her, there was a point where she had hurt her back. I think she'd like slipped a disc or something had happened where like she couldn't walk. She ended up having to be in a wheelchair for like a brief amount of time. Your face looks like you might already know this story.
Carry on.
Okay. So what happened, like we were in bed one day, and like she got up to like go to the toilet and then screamed out for me. I was like, what the fuck? So I went and like something happened. She like could hardly move. So I had to like help her back to the bed, and then like we had had to like go sort out getting a lift to like go to the doctors and see what was up. But in the process of that, like she needed to go back to the bathroom, so I had to help her back to the bathroom again. And her period had started. And so I had to help her put a tampon in. And the way she told this story on that podcast was that like she had said that she had her period, and then I just like didn't say anything and just like pulled out a tampon and like put it up there or something. Like she made it seem like I was just like, all right, cool, there, you're good to go, and like I'm some sort of fucking freak. That's not what happens at all. I asked if she like needed a hand and if she was all right with me doing it, because like I work in care, so I've done stuff like this before, so like it's not alien to me. Like I do it as like a job. And so she was like, yeah. So I hadn't put a tampon in anyone before, but I'd done similar things like sanitary wise with other like people I'd supported. So like I was like, all right, you cool if like I help you, because she couldn't move. Like she could not move. She was in pain. So yeah, so like I helped and she was like, that was weird. And so it was so weird that like something happened on a previous episode that she had heard that, and she was like, oh, that's like when this happened. So like she emailed in her story, and then they told the story, but they told it the way she wrote it, which made me sound like a freak. And then like Chris and Rosie were like, what the fuck, who is this guy? And it I didn't think there was anything too weird about it.
That's
was
fairly wholesome, really. Yeah. In the grand scheme of things, it's pretty wholesome.
We were. I think at that point we knew that the relationship was pretty serious.
Yeah. Oh, God bless you, the future Lauren Carter, for allowing that
anonymity.
That's the word. You all had to hear me struggle with that word. I'm not taking that out. God bless her. And
when I messaged her saying, is it okay if I tell the story that you put on Shag Married Annoyed? And she said, ha ha ha, yeah, but please refer to me as your fiance, because that's all she cares about now because we're engaged. She's like, just make sure everyone knows.
That's the thing. If anything happens, I do like to remind Kelly that I am her husband, and vice versa. Obviously, if she says wife, because that would be weird. If she says
I couldn't do that in the last relationship because I didn't give a fuck. This time it means something. It's nice.
Thanks.
That's a whole other point. We're not getting into my previous marriage problems.
Let's not. No, we had the bit at the start. We went up.
The anti-anxiety meds that I took prior to coming on this are starting to wear off. We won't get that deep again.
Let's go back. Let's finish up with actual some wrestling stuff to
wrestle. That's what an idea. Let's try.
Exactly. Well, I mean, I'm looking at the time. It's like, oh my god, it's almost 9 o'clock. It's like almost my bedtime.
I've got a PS5, Billy.
I know. Have I really just been keeping you on this long so you can't play your PS5? That's the big question.
But see, do you know what? I gave up the thought of even having a PS5 because every time somewhere came in stock, I'd be in a queue and then it wouldn't happen. And I was like, oh, fuck it. So, like, the money I had saved away for getting a PS5, I ended up being like, ah, fuck it. And I bought Lauren a Switch and Animal Crossing for it and stuff like that because she's mad on Animal Crossing and she hasn't played it since she had like a DS. So I was like, I give up. I'm not getting a PS5. Here's something nice. You can have this. And then I got the thing through being like, oh, you can get a PS5 and just add it to your phone contract and pay it up a month. It's like, so I think it's karma. Like, my good karma is the reason why I've actually ended up getting a PS5. So yeah, well, it's fine. I've waited this long. I can wait.
Oh, another 10 minutes or so.
another half hour.
Maybe. So, right. So, wrestling chat.
I'm just getting you prepared for having to stay up when you've got this baby. Like, you're not going to get enough sleep. This is...
You see, people say this, but I'm a world-weary wrestling fan who stayed up to all hours in the morning to watch live pay-per-view. Premium live events. And I am prepared. People don't think I am because I'm a man-child. But, you know, I think I'm okay. I'll be fine.
They will try to unbox every single one of those Funkos behind you.
I've already put in a request when we were decorating this room that I am getting a bookshelf with stuff that I could put over the front of it. Just like a glass front. Might have to wipe it every so often, finger marks, but you know, I've already, as long as they don't touch the belt. If they don't touch the belt, we'll be all right. Because
touch the belt, you'll get the belt. Like normally with parenting, like if someone threatens a belt, it's like a leather belt. Like, it's like you're just like shot to the head.
You come for the championship. You better not miss. I'm gonna run through.
I take it all back. You're fully prepared for parenting. Wrestling.
Right. Okay. So we tried to end the show in the season, particularly with the same question, which is your dream match. So we know we've discussed in previous episodes your dream match being like likes of Gene Money and all that kind of stuff.
That's one of my goals. Yeah.
One of your goals. 100%. But this is your ultimate. This is your end game kind of thing. So you get the main event of your chosen favorite promotions big show. So WrestleMania, Wrestle Kingdom, whatever AEW.
Hell for Lycra.
at a sold out Caird Hall, you can
they're hanging from the rafters. No, they're hanging from the cage.
You know, the worst thing is we can't even mention the participants because one of them's on a list. So
no, normally with like wrestling lists it's top 10. You're number one.
He's definitely number one in Dundee and Fife area.
The other one was all right, you know, the other guy.
Oh, yeah, aye.
How about Magmar's?
Yeah, he had a podcast for a bit, I think. The Piston Broke, you know, Piston Broke podcast. Unfortunately, all his guests are, yeah, probably can't. Well, I can't mention them either. Anyway, no. We're finishing on a high.
Right.
Okay. You get to pick your opponents. You get to pick the match stipulation. So opponent or opponents. So you've got anything. You could have your December to Dismember Extreme Elimination Chamber with five participants that you wish. You've got the main event of the show. You get to pick your opponents, the match. Who would it be?
Right. I think, so I would, it would be Craig Berry. Bless him. What I'd do, I'd have us start as a tag team. I'd have us have like a big tag team run, and then like say like we won tag titles and then we lose them, and then after it he turns on me, I disappear, he goes on a big like B singles push, I reappear, say at like the Rumble, make it WrestleMania, he wins a world title, I reappear at the Rumble, big surprise, I win the Rumble, and then me and him like have a big long build up to it, and then me versus Craig. That's like that would probably be like the dream, because like me and him, we've like we're pretty close in this, like we're pretty tight. So I'd say probably that if we're thinking logically, but if we're going completely out the box. I would have a death match against Arn Anderson with his Glock, and it would literally just be ring the bell, he shoots me, pins me. I want to have like a death match where like it is actually like he has tried to kill me. Legit, like he's pulled out a gun. Fucking, how can you call anything else a death match after that? Done. That.
I feel like you've had a chat with Ian Skinner Because Ian Skinner likes to bring up guns when it comes to anything involved with death matches. I don't know if it's just a kindred spirit. He has a kind of...
Like, part of me has, like, a bit of a death wish. Like, so I'm just... I would love to do death matches, but then also, just the whole Arn Anderson and his glove thing, like, that popped me so much. I was like, imagine, like, there was a match and he actually just did pull out his, like... I'd do that. I'd do that for him, one last rub before, you know. Because can anyone really say, like, can anyone remember what Arn Anderson's last match was? Does anyone know it off the top of their head?
No.
Would they remember it if it was against a guy and it was a death match and he pulled out a gun? I think they would, I'd do him the favor. That. So.
Listen, kid, I know you've been around for a while, but I'll let you shoot me.
Is this a work or a shoot? Both, technically.
I see you, Arn, with your bald head and your beard, just like every other wrestler here. Arn Anderson might shoot me.
I think I would build me and Craig as a team, and then we'd do the split. Inevitably, we can like come back to being a team later, but like do the split, and then I, you know, rightfully take whatever singles title he has off of him because I'm the better man, and because he said that wrestling was anime for rednecks, and I will never fucking forgive him for that. That piece of shit.
Of course, it would have to end in a kennel from hell.
There we go.
That's, there's the ender. That's the show ender.
That's it.
That's the best way.
You've still not asked me who would win in a fight.
Have I never asked you that?
You've never asked.
Well, this is what we're ending on then. So I thought I had asked you. My apologies. Oh. So the last question on this epically long podcast that maybe had some wrestling in it somewhere. What would win in a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
One cow.
You just full stop there. You've had enough time to think about it. Cool. That's fine.
Do you know what? I thought of an answer like a while, because I was like, you'll get to ask me that because you didn't ask me it the last time I was on. And then I reminded you of the question. And when I did it, I forgot what my answer, like what my reasoning was for it. I had a reason.
I love this question because I think it's stupid. It's a stupid question, right. but people take it seriously.
I remember the answer. Right. If the two sheep are next to one another facing the cow, then the cow would win if he can see both of them at the same time. But if the cow is in between the two sheep and he can only see one at a time, they have an advantage because one can attack from behind. So if the cow can see both the sheep, if they're both coming at him from the same direction, the cow would win because the cow is stronger than two sheep. But if the sheep manage to play the numbers game and go all shield surround them, then the sheep would win. That's what I think.
I have now asked this question to former WWE stars, Ring of Honor stars, anyone who's has been in the wrestling business for the last 100 episodes I've done, and people take this question far seriously than I built up to be, and I love it. I love it for just that reason that people start, like, I say it and they go, like, they laugh, go, that's a silly question, and they go, what would win in a fight? So thank you to Krieger and Luke King Sharp for bringing this question to my attention and for it to be forever used. If you want to support us with that particular question, buy the Field t-shirt that's on our t-shirt store. I think that's the natural end of this. So where can people find the Fair City Hooligan Brent Carter on social media?
I am on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all Brent Carter FCH. My TikTok is Fair City Hooligan. Mostly because I was like, I wasn't going to put the Brent Carter name in that because, like, there's some wrestling stuff, but then there's just some, like, regular me stuff as well. So it's a bit of a mix. So I didn't, yeah. I'm on YouTube. You can see my match where I beat Kerr. Any other matches involving me don't technically exist if you can't see the footage. So I am undefeated. Onlyfans.com/Brent Carter FCH. It's not a joke, it's a genuine thing. I'm not naked in it. It's literally just like, it's basically like what you do with Patreon. It's, I have an OnlyFans instead, just to say I've got an OnlyFans. It's fun. Like, so like all my photos from the photo shoots that I've got with like Chris are on there. I'm putting videos up where like I've got my matches, but then I'm talking over the top of it. So I'm telling you like what was going on prior to the match and like how we came up with stuff doing that. What else have I got? You can buy my t-shirts on wrestletees.co.uk. It might be .com. But if you go on my Twitter or my Facebook, like there's a wee bio link thing. You click on that, it's got the links to everything. You can find me easy enough.
Well, perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking almost 2 hours of your time to just I don't think we really spoke about just wrestling in general. So this has been catch up
chaos. Yes.
At least we haven't sang.
That's, you know what? There's still time.
Tell me why. No, I can't go through that again.
Nothing but a... Okay.
Oh God, no. I need to leave now. But perfect. Thank you very much again. And we'll call that a day.